All right, what's up? Tim Sykes here with Jack Kellogg, going over his whole journey. We actually just took a little lunch break. Click the links below if you want to see the earlier parts to this video. It's fascinating to hear, you know, not just the successes, but about the trials, the tribulations, the failures, the losses, the mistakes, the bamboo pillows along the way. That's going to stick with me. Next time you see a bamboo pillow, you're going to think about Jack Kellogg. And it's going to be a good lesson for you. Anyways, we left off mid-2020 after you have made, what, half a million roughly? Right before LCDX.
This was 600, 700.
Six or 700. Just a little reminder, 90 to 95, maybe even 99% of traders lose. So don't expect this kind of success. If you watch the earlier video lessons, expect bamboo pillow type failure, okay? That's what most traders go through. You're not alone if you have failure. You're not alone if you have losses. But you can learn from stories like this where he has emerged from the rubbles and the ashes of this industry. Remember the beginning of Terminator 2 where the robots are crushing the human skulls?
No. Nope.
That's you. You are the robot and the rest of the trading industry is the human skulls. He doesn't know. He hasn't seen the movie. But if you've seen it, then you understand. Where was your mindset when you're at like 600,000 or 700,000? After already, you know, the previous year was your best year, a little over 100,000. Now, midway through 2020, you've already made like $500,000 roughly. So you've more than tripled your previous year. Where's your mindset? Do you want more? Do you want to pull back? Or are you somewhere in between?
I want more.
You say that with a guilty smile. And you know that you shouldn't want more. You should be happy with what you have, but you can't ignore the opportunities.
Mm-hmm. It's just... So now kind of flashback to like 2019 and like that 6 month stretch of like 5K, like 3K, like lack of opportunities, right?
And mind you, 3K, 5K, that's very good for most people.
Mm-hmm.
Just a little perspective.
Yeah, it's good in the real world for sure. But for me, it wasn't good just because I hold myself to a higher standard.
So you think that you're better than most people?
Yeah.
Damn, dude! This is getting honest. This is getting transparent. What he means by that is that he studied harder, he's worked harder, he deserves his success in a humble way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just confidence. And I know that I can do better. I know I always can do better. And that's what keeps like pushing me to do better is that I know I can do better every single time. Like I don't just like be like, oh, I'm just like... Like, it's always, I can do a little bit better here. I could have sized a little bit here. I could have paid better attention here. Like, you always can be a little bit better. And I find if you just put in the reps and the experience every day and you just keep pushing yourself, like, you can keep getting to that next level, next level, next level, next level. And it's very rewarding once you get, you know, into the stage that I'm now at. Like, it's a very meaningful amount of money. But it starts very small and it's all about that process. Like my first month, you know, it was 10K. And now that just build it up over and over and over. But anyway.
And to clarify, it's not just about getting better, bigger profits. It's executing the trades better, mm-hmm. taking advantage of the opportunities. And if you focus on trading properly, you know, maybe with small size when it's not a great setup, maybe with bigger size when it's one of your setups, you get more satisfaction over the good execution. The money is just a way to keep track. It's just a scorecard. It's mm-hmm. not like Jack likes to say, oh, I need all this money. Like, you know, I need all these nice things. He's not doing it that way. So I want to be very clear about that because, I've had students like this, like Tim Grittani went parabolic. I went parabolic. All of us, we've done very well, but it wasn't because we needed like luxuries in life. It was because we saw the opportunities. We wanted to capitalize on them when they're there.
Yeah, I just wanted to execute better, really, and that's what it just comes down to. And then usually, though, like, the more money I make, usually it's the better I execute. But sometimes it's not always the case where sometimes I'll be green on a trade, but I'll feel terrible because I feel like I executed poorly. But I would say majority of the time, like, the more I make, the better I executed.
But sometimes you might also lose a little money and execute well, and you're happy with that.
That too.
A lot of people watching this are like, no, if you have a loss, it's a bad trade. But sometimes, for whatever reason, you get into a trade, maybe there's news, maybe the market moves against you, something you can't control, something that you couldn't see happening. And the best course of option is just to cut losses. And that's not your fault. Like, you lose 100, you lose 5,000, you lose, you know, when you get bigger account size, sometimes you lose 10,000. We'll get into that in a second. 20,000, 30,000, 35,000.
Yeah, so that's coming later, but let's get back into August. That's kind of where we picked off,
We're keeping it.
All right, let's get back into August.
Let's pick off LCDX.
LCDX, that was my best trade of August. It wasn't my new best gain just because there wasn't enough shares available. I tried getting as many as I could.
You and Kyle took all the shares.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I wanted to short the stock. I don't even short that much, but I wanted to short it. Why did we all want to short it?
So basically, it was up for the wrong reason. They were portraying themselves as Lucid Motors, which is an electric vehicle company. It's a hype sector where a lot of people are buying right now. If you look at Tesla, NIO,
the stocks, electric vehicles.
Yep.
We got to clarify.
Yeah, they've just been going parabolic for a few months now, and it's a very hot sector. So LCDX pumped themselves as that, and I think the stock went from like a buck to, what, six bucks?
Six, yeah. There was also a stutter step along the way where it looked like it was going to start tanking in the fours, and then it trapped everyone in the fours, early shorts, and then it had one last gasp. If you've ever seen Pacific Rim, have you seen Pacific Rim? Not a great movie, but there's a giant alien, and they think that they've beaten the alien, and they're all celebrating, and the alien has one last gasp and kills one of the main characters.
Yeah, kind of like RIVX.
I always remember that in Pacific Rim. Even though that's science fiction, there's usually one last, not usually, but sometimes, a last gasp.
Yeah, you always got to be careful for that last squeeze out, because that's what can get you, and that can make you miss the big trade, because potentially you burn too much mental capital, you gave your accounts not big enough to like take a hit like that. So you really got to be careful for that last gasp, and always just have your guard up, you know what I mean, and expect the unexpected. But when this news did come out that it was not the right company, and it got the CE, which is the caveat emptor, which basically is something on OTC markets where it says, this stock is a fraud, this is a promotion, don't buy the stock. And a lot of times,
it's a skull and crossbones. Yeah. It's like a warning sign. Actually, someone just messaged me today saying that Schwab is no longer going to let you trade any skull and crossbones.
E-Trade too.
There you go.
So it basically just, it makes it so there's not many buyers and then everybody wants to sell. So I saw the news very quickly and I got short all that I could. And I think I got short around 5:35, and then the stock just basically unwound for the next 2 hours down to a low of like a buck. I covered at 180. I left some money on the table.
But you took the meat of the move.
I took the meat of the move.
I saw you and Kyle being like, "Oh, we could have made more," and I was like, "Be happy with your 35 grand in one day."
Mm-hmm. So it was a great trade. I think I made 67%, like on the short side within 2 hours. Like, that's a phenomenal trade.
And you took all the shares to short. Understand, LCDX, I remember it because I don't short very much and I wanted to short it and there were no shares anywhere. This guy had taken them all. This guy and his little Santa's helper named Kyle, they took them all. All of the shares. And this happens sometimes. I'm not bitter. I actually like it when students do better than me. But that's just how limited some of these trades can be. This is frankly why I like going long better. There's no such limits. So LCDX, wrong ticker. Wrong news. This happens. In case you didn't realize, like, this is what penny stock trading and low price stock trading is all about. Like, misinformation causing erroneous pricing. LCDX did not deserve to go from 1 to 4, let alone from 1 to 6. And it came all the way back down to 1 when people realized, you know, the error of their ways.
Yeah. So it was a phenomenal opportunity, phenomenal, like, just something to witness. I would compare it to a ticker last year, CLCI. I don't know if you remember that,
yeah.
But that went on a run from cents to like $3. And I actually got short pre-market when the CE came out at like 250. But this is when my account was smaller, so it was only like a couple thousand shares. But I got short at like 250 and the stock opened up at like $1.50. And it was so cool. And then it just washed to like $1 and I covered it and it kept going lower. You know how it goes. Like, these stocks just basically go to back to the ground where they started from. So I knew that from last year, which kind of gave me preparation for LCDX, and my mind just kind of, it picked it up very quickly what was going on. And I think I got the best entry possible. Like I saw it right when it came out, and then like I shorted it and I was like, okay, like it hasn't done anything yet, because I realized I was the first one to see it, but then it started spreading and then just went down. So that was a great way to close up August. And August was just under 100,000. I think it was at 95,000.
In profits.
For the month, yeah.
You gotta say profit. People don't understand. Like, what's like 100,000? Like 100,000 shares, $100,000.
$95,000 in profits.
Thank you.
In August.
By the way, stocks and trade breaking news did alert LCDX. That's how I saw it. And mm-hmm. I, you know, wanted it. For a second, I just gotta go to your point about seeing patterns from the day before, or like the month before or year before. I keep seeing, I think there's like someone driving up the driveway, but it's just the reflection. It really helps to see a pattern or a play from the past. My example, I'm actually working on a holiday guide right now. We're going to include the holiday guide below this video. All the how to use stocks to trade breaking news. And one of the examples I went over was SSFT did a deal with Google, SEC filing. I bought it. It was one of my biggest trades of 2020. Very similar to LQMT a decade ago doing an SEC filing with Apple. Still no press release. We have no idea what they did, but I made 55% there, and then I made 58% a decade apart. But sometimes the same pattern applies. And LCDX, this is not the first or the last time that someone's just going to get the wrong ticker and the wrong stock is going to spike big. It's like ridiculous. So congrats on seeing it, you know, from before and then pouncing this time. And now when the next time it happens, you'll have those two as examples and you'll be like, oh, let me try to be aggressive next time.
Mm-hmm. So
not that it's going to work every time.
Yeah.
It could be too early.
Could be too early and get squeezed. But it's just that, it's that experience just paying off and just putting in the reps and seeing it over time. And that's what makes the difference, is that experience, really.
What did your parents think at this point where you're making $95,000 in a month? Are they like, take the money out, there's something going on?
At this point, like, even now they're like, you got to like slow down, like go easy. Like, and I just keep like pedal to the metal, like keep going.
They're right. You should be conservative because you're having a ridiculous amount of gains. Like you've never had this kind of gains before. Like your mindset might not be fully there, mm-hmm. you know, maybe.
No, I'm definitely taking it.
Maybe.
Taking it with precaution. And I'm always thinking about what I'm doing, because like, I don't want to give a lot back. Like, I made this, I deserve it. So I don't want to like give back my money for dumb errors.
I got a message the other day from a challenge student, and they're like making $500 a day for the past 2 weeks on like a $20,000 account. And they're like, what's going on? Like, is there some kind of catch? Like, there's like, and they're messaging me because they're making money. They see it in their account, but they think like they're being punked or something. Right. And I'm like, I understand this is just 2020. It is not always going to be this plentiful with plays. Stocks spiking huge, stocks dropping huge. We don't always have this volatility. So learn from it while you can and maximize it. That's my mm-hmm. little tip. There's no catch. The catch is that it is not always going to be like this.
Yeah, so you just got to learn as you go and adapt. But moving forward into September of 2020. In September,
we're filming this in December 2020. So we're talking, we're going month by month, because this is when things, right now you're at what, 700, 800K?
Yeah, I think this was, remember when I said the goal's in sight?
Yeah.
I think that was, I think I'm around 800,000 here.
Yeah, and your goal was to make a million.
Mm-hmm. So my goal was
like,
to make a million.
Calm down, like, don't worry about milestones. I think that's probably what I replied.
Mm-hmm. So.
And you're like, okay, and then you just ignored me.
So moving on to September, it was a really slow month for a lot of people. The first couple of weeks, there wasn't really anything. Like, I remember it was just a bunch of illiquid tickers, like Tuesday Q, TUSEQ, GTXMQ. It was just illiquid stocks that didn't really have good patterns. And I was still trading them, but I wasn't really making a meaningful amount, like maybe like a couple thousand here and there. But it wasn't really, like, to go from June, almost double six, like 184,000 in profits, July, 125,000. August, 95,000. So that, as I said, like the beginning of the year was like 20, 50, 70,000 per month. And now it's like 184, 125, 100. And then September, like, it really started cooling off. And thinking back to last year, September was really slow last year too. It was when DCGD was running and I was just getting chopped up on that. And then like after the conference in September is when I started getting my footing back. But this September too was really choppy, and September is statistically my worst month. Not including September 2018, that was my first profitable month, but like the last two Septembers were the pretty much the worst months for me. So this September too was super choppy, and I wasn't up too much. Maybe I was up like 20,000 the first 2 weeks. And at this point, I was invited on a trip by Sykes to go to Arizona, and a bunch of my friends were going out there just to film and like hang out. And this was like the first time I've been away from like my screens, my monitors in a long time. So it's very new to me. Like it's a new kind of feeling, you know what I mean? And it's like, yeah, I'm there, but it's like, okay, what am I missing? Like, and I just felt like I was missing a lot. I saw like a few stocks going parabolic, and NVNXF or something was a Tesla play that went up big, and I missed that and missed a few others. And that kind of just like, it gave me FOMO, just like not being there, FOMO, fear of missing out. So I was super tired, and like I was flying from Connecticut to Arizona to Miami, back to Connecticut, all within like a few days. And flying, like I'm not the best flyer either. Like I get a little bit motion sickness sometimes, and it just really burns me out, like going from different time zones and stuff. So I recommend.
And you were moving.
And I was moving too. Like I was super stressed out basically because I was going on the trip, and then the next day I had to like start moving my apartment like all out, and then moving into my new apartment basically in a week I was going from Connecticut to Arizona to Miami, back to Connecticut, packing up my entire apartment, going to my dad's to stay for a night, then the next morning leaving to go to New Hampshire, and then setting up my entire apartment, and then like getting settled in, all in 1 week. So it was very stressful, and I couldn't fully focus on trading, and this was the only two red weeks of the year for me. Because it kind of overlapped because I was still tired from the previous month. But basically when I got home from Miami into Connecticut before I started moving, I immediately got home from the Uber. It was like 2 p.m. or something. I was like, all right, got on the computer. As soon as I got home, I was super tired from everything, got right on the computer. I was like, all right, what am I going to trade? And I pulled up NVNXF and I saw it was moving big. And then I was like, oh, I'll buy some. Like this looks good for a gap up. And then it started like failing into the close. I was like, okay, I'll just add a little bit more. Like, this is fine. Like, nice dip.
Everything's fine.
And it just kept dipping. And I was just sitting there. And then like, boom, like 6K loss, like new biggest long loss I've ever taken. And I was just like, oh, why did I do that to myself? Like, I'm so tired. Why am I doing it? Like, it's so painful. And then the next day, unfortunately, the next day was ticker symbol SPI. Went up like 4,000%. And for me, like, I've never been a fan of like the energy sector just because like the daily charts don't really like make too much sense for me. But basically, I missed SPI, and then the next play was Sun W, which was a sympathy. And
NPECK.
NPECK. I didn't trade that one, but I did trade Sun W.
I did.
Sun W, I went long, maybe at like a buck, and I sold at like a buck 20, went to like 450 or something. And I was like, oh my God, like I left so much on the table. And I was up like a few thousand, but I was still red from the day before. So I was kind of like, this is perfect opportunity. Why am I only up 3,000? And that was the bad mindset, obviously. And then the stock crashed from like four to like a buck 50. And then I took way too big of a position. And the stock just didn't bounce. I had a chance to get out for break even. Like I had that few second hesitation.
Interval.
Yeah. Interval to get out for break even. And I just didn't take it. And then.
Why didn't you take it?
I was like, this is going to bounce more. Like it's down from four to like a buck. Like this is going to bounce to two.
Greed.
At least.
Greed.
Yeah. It was super greedy.
Once he started traveling and being exhausted, he got behind on like his like mental curve of what he theoretically should be making. Because you're having a record year, it's like, okay, I should be doing this. There's these opportunities, I should make this. But because he wasn't in the right mindset, because he was like, frankly, behind on some of these moves, and he wasn't necessarily adapting, he was forcing his plays being a little too late, being a little too aggressive, and it cost him.
Mm-hmm. So basically what happened was it started failing down to like, I think I was in from 170 and then it failed down to like 150. And I was like, I was starting to like sweat a little bit. I think I was down like 10 grand at this point. And I was like, and then it bounced back a little bit. And like, I could have gotten out for like a 5K loss. And then like, it just went down lower and I just market sold like out. Like it broke the 150 low. I market sold out. I got out. Like they filled me 135. Like it was terrible. Oh, and keep in mind, I sold the dead bottom at 135 just to watch the stock come back. And I was just so mentally drained at this point. Like now I'm like 25 grand like off my highs. Like I just lost 25K basically in 2 days. And keep in mind, like when I was trading Sun W, like when I came back to like trade it, like that day I had to pack up my entire apartment. So like I was going to my dad's to like get stuff and like I was literally packing boxes and like trading. So I was like packing a box, like going back to my computer, like packing a box, going back to my computer.
Not a good trading environment.
Nope.
Trading is very like fragile. I hope you understand this and I hope you learn from this story because like when you're on, you know, shorting LCDX 35K in a day, you know, when you're on with trading a lot of these OTC breakouts or, you know, shorting really anything that's collapsing on a first red day. It feels good to be on, but when you're off, it can get very scary very quickly. Mm-hmm. And you learn that. 25K, that was your quickest 25K loss ever.
Mm-hmm. So basically, like that was my biggest drawdown I've ever had. And I mean, it hurt. It was my first red week of the year. And it just sucked because like my uncle and my cousin came over, like all, like then I had to like literally move my entire apartment just like feeling like absolute crap. Like I just lost like 18 grand and like all my family and friends are over like helping me move and like I'm just like sluggish like and every like I'm literally moving my entire apartment and I just feel so bad and then I finally move it and it's just more work. It's like, oh, go pick up a pizza for us, like go like pay your uncle, like they just helped you. And I'm just like, oh my god, like this is just so much. And I was just basically done. Like I literally just like I ate like a little bit of food. I was just sick to my stomach. Like I had a little bit of food and then I just like didn't say anything. I just got up and I just like went into my room and I just...
You're just mentally checked out.
I just mentally checked out. And then I woke up the next morning. Like I slept into like 10:30. I didn't want to even have a chance to look at the market. And then I look at Sun W. $8. $8. And then...
So you're on the right track.
Not really. Like, that wasn't my thesis that I was going to gap up.
I get it, but, like, For me, I get encouraged when I have a loss or, you know, if I exit too soon. Like, on my latest REFR, where it just spiked an hour out after I sold it. Like,
yeah.
I'm not mad that I missed out. Like, I'm like, oh, okay, it did that. Like, I register that. Mm-hmm. You might not have thought that it would go from the ones to the eights, but you thought that it would bounce.
Mm-hmm.
You were kind of on the right track, but you were too early. You're mentally checked out.
Yep,
this is how delicate trading is, okay? You can have the right thesis. You can eventually be right. But if your timing is off, I mean, you might get screwed. You might lose a lot. So think about that.
Yeah. So that was basically a huge lesson for me. And then moving forward, like, if I'm traveling, if I'm moving, if I have a lot of in my personal life, you literally just need to accept, like, it's impossible, like, to trade with a clear head. And just moving forward, I think that I'll be more... delicate with trading. Like I thought, like literally I could just trade and move and like be fine with like big size and like big opportunities. The thing is like the volatility that day was just so unreal. Like I said, Sun W 1 to 4, back down to 1, next day at 8, SPI went from 1 to 40. Like the volatility is just so dangerous that day. It's just not a good day to be a trader or not a good day to be a mentally checked out trader because it's really dangerous.
If you're off by a little bit, it can really mm-hmm. add up quickly.
But like that was one of the best things that actually ever happened to me, because moving forward, I hadn't been able to scale up going long, and like my E-Trade account has now gone like absolutely parabolic. We'll get into that later. Next month was October,
What did you finish for September?
September finished up $3,700. So I gave back, like I said, the first 2 weeks were slow. So I gave back most of my money and I just checked out for basically the rest of the month. And the next week after, like my, when I was moved in, there was not much opportunity at all. And I was still tired and still trying to recover. So I had another small, like, negative 2K week.
I like that you're going over, you know, trade by trade, week by week, month by month, because this is not a normal job. Like, people try to make this into, like, a 9-to-5 job. Like, oh, I get paid this much per week or this month per month. And sometimes it doesn't matter what you want. You could say, oh, I'm mentally prepared this week. Give me all the trades. And then there's nothing. You could be totally, you know, mentally checked out, and then there's a lot of plays, and forget about nothing, then you lose big. So all you can do is try your best to be prepared every single day, every single week. Understand that life gets in the way. Sometimes you're traveling, sometimes your personal life, sometimes whatever, you know? Like, this is all part of it. It's not an exact science, and you're not getting a regular paycheck weekly or bi-monthly.
Mm-hmm. So that's what it is with trading. Like, it's always something. That's why I like it too, because it's always something new. Like, the patterns and everything kind of are the same, and like, every stock's a little bit unique and a little bit different, but like Tim says, like, the patterns rhyme, you know what I mean? So everything's kind of similar, but like, you always have to be adapting and like, changing your game just a little bit based on what's happening in your personal life. Like, the trader checklist, right? There's so many things, like, how do you feel, like, time of day, the catalyst, the pattern, the volume, the price of the stock, everything plays a role into the sector. Everything plays a role into the trade. And as you go and as you learn, you'll know kind of what works for you. And like, you'll make mistakes like I did. And now I know when my personal life is really busy, I shouldn't be trading that much. So
I like what you said, like, where stocks, like, every stock has like a rhyme, mm-hmm. you know, if you put in enough study time. Whether you make a dollar a share, 50 cents, or a dime.
Oh! That was pretty good, I'm not going to lie.
I was just thinking about that as you said it. I was like, let me think of three rhymes. Let me be a rapper.
So, moving on to October.
In the next video, click some links below. We're going to talk about all this stuff so that you can review it. We don't want to overwhelm you too quickly. We don't want like a Jackaroo September issue with you. So click some links, leave a comment below, let me know, let Jack know if you've ever had, you know, just like some bad trades, like, you know, you're off mentally, you're busy in life, you know, maybe the market's a little slow. Be honest about it, be open about it, it's good. You know, this is like confession for Jack, so, you know, this is cool. So study up.